As you may remember, one of the downsides of the mega mergers of the mid-1990s was a dramatic downturn or a dramatic turn for the worse in operations as the merged railroads were unable to communicate with one another. Our members died on the law by the hundreds every day. They were left to rot on trains for unconscionable periods of time. By 2006, we had data on literally hundreds of thousands of instances of crews taking 14 hours or more to make a trip. And in 2007, we began to lobby Congress for two changes to the Hours of Service Act to address fatigue. One was to require an 8-hour call prior to work instead of receiving 8 hours off duty after work. The other was to overturn a 1996 Supreme Court decision on limbo time, and to require the carrier to get an outlawed crew off of the train prior to the expiration of 12th hour. Since we were using the carrier's own data from two Class I railroads, we got the attention of Congress. In late 2007 and again in early 2008, Federal Railroad Administrator Joe Boardman and his team approached us about supporting FRA's proposal that the agency be given complete regulatory authority over hours of service. BLET had an excellent relationship with Joe Boardman and with FRA's top people at the time, and we had worked closely to benefit our members over the years. But with the presidential election, with an uncertain outcome looming in November of 2008, we were just not prepared to give the keys to the store to the FRA. We had no way of knowing who would be the administrator when the dust settled in 2009. In any event, our hours of service proposal became the first draft of the legislation put together by the House Transportation and Infrastructure Committee, and a game of musical chairs began. Each of the groups involved had their own agenda. FRA had theirs, the House and Senate committees had differing objectives, the AAR, the Short Line Association, and the APTA had their own similar goals. And of course, the late UTU National Legislative Director had his own agenda. Over time, the legislative language morphed into the language that is in effect today. But that isn't the end of the story. We continue to work with the AAR and the UTU to make changes more palatable for us. In early September of 2008, we reached agreement with the AAR and the UTU to jointly sponsor a pair of amendments to the draft bill. One would have reduced time off duty at the away-from-home terminal from 10 hours undisturbed to 8 hours undisturbed. The other would have dropped excess limbo time and time spent in other mandatory service from the 276-hour cap. Unfortunately, the tragic Chatsworth, California accident happened within a matter of days after the three groups reported to Congress that we had agreed on these changes. As a result of the public outcry over the number of fatalities and other casualties, Congress grabbed the bill that was on the shelf because it included mandatory PTC, and they pushed it through both houses. That still isn't the end of the story, though, because we continue to work today for more favorable interpretations, technical amendments, and waivers so that the system better meets the needs of BLET members. And we won't quit fighting until Congress and FRA get it right. On the regulatory side of the House, the BLET continues to play a leading role in the FRA's Railroad Safety Advisory Committee, or the RSAC. We are represented on every one of RSAC's 14 active working groups and 10 task forces. More than 24 BLET officers, members, consultant, and staff are participating in this huge effort, which covers everything from locomotive cab conditions to PTC, operating rules, track and bridge standards, medical standards, conductor certification, hours of service, and more. For example, on hours of service, the full RSAC is now voting on proposed regulations for intercity passenger and commuter service. Because all assignments other than extra boards in this type of service are scheduled, we were able to persuade the RSAC to endorse a regulation that does not depart significantly from the current system. Even more importantly, our team helped develop a substantial body of scientific data that we believe will provide a basis for relief from the current freight hours of service problems for scheduled freight assignments. Turning to our arbitration department, we continue to set the standard for all of rail labor. We have, I think, the best winning percentage amongst all the unions, and we provide a tremendous amount of support for all of our general committees. We also do a great job of assisting local chairmen so that they can progress the strongest case possible, and it's the teamwork from the earliest stages of the process that establishes a foundation for victory when a case gets to the board or the first division. While I'm at it, and although this isn't strictly under the arbitration department's jurisdiction, I want to recognize the National Division team that provides engineer certification support services for what they do. It's great work. In less than 18 months, they have cleared up a backlog of nearly 24 cases, provided assistance to numerous general committees and local chairmen, helped members get financial settlements with railroads, and protected important legal rights. And all the while, they do keep up with their day jobs. The BLET's Public Relations Department is doing a great job, too. It's stepping up to meet some new challenges. Earlier this year, we added an art director to our team, and he is making a tremendous contribution to the appearance of the Locomotive Engineer and Trainman News, in addition to allowing us to do a couple of other things. We have taken the National Legislative Office's Ties to Washington newsletter and revamped it completely. We've broadened distribution to include those members who make a significant PAC contribution every month. And as you may have noticed, last month we reintroduced our quarterly magazine, which has been renamed the Locomotive Engineers and Trainmen Journal. When the IBT decided earlier this year to stop publishing the Rail Teamster magazine, we resumed publishing our quarterly magazine. So our membership now is better informed than ever, not only about what the National Division and the National Legislative Office are doing, but also about what's happening at every level of the BLET. Regarding education and training, we continue to provide a broad array of programs in concert with the National Labor College and the generous assistance of the North American Railway Foundation. Every year, we train hundreds of BLET officers to become more proficient, and we're particularly proud of our new Advanced General Chairman and Advanced Local Chairman programs. Our Department of Internal Organizing, Mobilizing, and Strategic Planning is also in a rebuilding phase. After being used extensively from the mid-1990s through 2001, the BLET's mobilization network was underutilized until about a year ago, when parts of it were dusted off again to improve participation in a couple of contract ratification votes. More recently, partial mobilizations were done to defeat an amendment to gut Amtrak funding and to increase turnout in this summer's initiative vote. In each case, the mobilization efforts had a verifiable and positive impact on membership participation. However, much more work needs to be done to embed mobilization on a broad scale at every level of the organization. Later this week, if time permits, we will have a presentation on the mobilization network, and I urge you all to attend. This program is designed to strengthen and focus the BLET's efforts, and your leadership back at home is essential in order for mobilization to work. We also have a trainman department at the National Division. It was created to provide assistance in areas of concern to trainman members, and currently we have nearly 3,800 trainman members, which incidentally is close to the number of engineers who belong to the UTU. Although almost all of these members work for railroads where UTU has exclusive representation for train service employees, we are very limited in what assistance we can provide. Also, because of the cooperation with UTU for the past 4 years on crew size, hours of service, and other common issues, I can report that there has been almost no rating by one of us on the other in that time. However, we continue to watch the continuing saga between the UTU and the sheet metal workers. If the sheet metal workers win their lawsuit to compel the merger, I expect that the trainman department will become very busy very quickly. Our short line department currently is being reconfigured as well. A previous administration had implemented a structure that grouped newly organized short line members from throughout the country into a single general committee. While this structure was appealing at the time, it turned out not to be as efficient as expected and also not as effective. That general committee has been disbanded, and now shortline members are being partnered with larger general committees who have the resources and people necessary to provide support. I'd like to take a moment right now to thank those general chairmen who have stepped up to the plate to assist our brothers and sisters from the smaller short lines. Thank you. Under the new configuration, the short line department will provide the support necessary to assist these general chairmen who are participating in this joint effort with us. And finally, our passenger department. At the present time, the department serves as a clearinghouse for items of interest and concern to our passenger general committees. It's also in a transitional mode because we finally have someone in the White House who understands how important passenger rail is to the national transportation system. Earlier this year, the Teamsters Rail Conference Policy Committee created a passenger rail advisory committee to advocate for increased high-speed rail and commuter rail service, and to fight to make sure, here's the key part, guys, that this work is performed by railroad workers who belong to railroad unions like the BLET and the BMWED. Internally, our support for the PRAC, as we call it, or the PRAC, will be provided by the National Legislative Board on the legislative and funding end, and the passenger department on the bargaining front. Speaking of Washington, I want to talk for a few minutes about the current political climate in the nation. The economy has been in really tough shape for more than 2 years now, and the evidence is all around us, except, of course, the turnaround in the nation's profits. Our highway transportation infrastructure is crumbling. We continue to be held captive by our dependency on foreign oil. And we have serious climate problems related to carbon fuel usage that we have to address as a nation. If there was ever a time for growth in rail transportation, this is it. And as rail transportation grows, so does BLET membership and BLET influence. At the same time, there is almost complete gridlock in Congress because of the philosophy of too many people that it's acceptable to harm the nation if that's what it takes to make sure the president can't achieve any of his agenda. It's partisan politics first and the country be damned. Even worse, it seems that a full quarter of the people of the United States of America make their political decisions based on some conspiracy theory, the rumor of the day, or on a single issue. On Tuesday, November 2nd, which is 4 weeks from tomorrow, Americans will again head to the polls to elect federal, state, and local officials. This means that the BLET will soon be releasing lists of candidates that we endorse for election. As in the case of every election, not everyone will be satisfied with whom we choose to endorse, because the BLET, after all, is like every other organization in this country, with members coming from all political stripes. In fact, everywhere I go, I'm asked by a member or an officer, why does the BLET support candidate X for office when he holds this position? Or why does the BLET support candidate Y for that office when she holds that position? Usually the position that our member objects to involves a social or other high-profile issue on which this nation is sharply divided. You may have read that I'm the son of a minister. I have a strong moral code. I learned at the dinner table growing up the values that my father preached, and he lived in his life, and I consider myself to be a good Christian. But as your national president, I am not the moral or spiritual leader of the BLET. I am the officer that was elected to lead the work of this great brotherhood to improve the economic conditions for our members and their families, to secure their health and welfare, to protect their pensions, and to do everything within my power to make sure that BLET members return to their families safe and sound after every day's work.